Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Ben Sadler. I'm one of the pastors at Victory of the Lamb Church in Franklin, and it's a privilege to be here. My connection to this place is my wife teaches second grade here, and our kids go to school at St. John's, and we're good friends with the Zach family, so it's a real privilege to share God's word with you this evening. We'll begin with our opening hymn, Rise My Soul to Watch and Pray. May the Lord bless your worship. Please stand. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin, for faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice. For the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do, you should cast me away from your presence forever. Though you warn me about Satan who seeks to destroy me, I so easily listen to his encouragement to follow my will instead of yours. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. I have good news. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In his great mercy, God made us alive in Christ even when we were dead in our sins. Hear the word of Christ through his called servant. I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Our first reading comes from Romans chapter 13, and when Paul was writing these words, I think he might have been been thinking about our text for this evening. We're going to be looking at the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus tells his disciples to stay awake and to not grow dreary or sleepy. And that's exactly what Paul says in Romans. Let no debt remain outstanding, except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. And do this, understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ, and do not think how to gratify the desires of the flesh. This is the word of the Lord. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation.
Though we do not see him now, we believe in him and are filled with joy.
He became the source of eternal salvation. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation.
We love him. Though we do not see him now, we believe in him and are filled with joy.
Our next reading comes from Mark chapter 14. This will be the focus for our sermon this afternoon, the account of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." The passion history of our Savior. Continue with our next hymn. Thank you. Grace and peace are yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We'll be focusing on those words from Mark chapter 14, the account of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for gathering us here this afternoon to hear from you. We pray that you would speak to us through your word, and don't let anything I'm doing get in the way of your Holy Spirit. In your name we pray, amen. Did you know that Lent is one of the oldest traditions in the Christian church? And there's a reason it has stood the test of time. It's really something we all need, even in our contemporary world. Lent is this 40-day journey that is supposed to remind us of Jesus' 40-day journey in the wilderness. And just like we take these 40 days in preparation for Holy Week, Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days in preparation for his ministry, and you could say in preparation for Holy Week. What I most appreciate about Lent is it has a way of stripping away any of our false narratives. It has a way of stripping away and showing us what is actually going on in our world, what the truth actually is. It really answers three important questions. As we go through this season, it reminds us where we really live, who we really are, and what we really need. Just think about the first day in Lent, Ash Wednesday, and I've heard that you guys traditionally usually put ashes on your forehead during this important day, and it starts that day, and when you come in on Ash Wednesday, usually you hear those words, remember, you are dust, and to dust you will return. The first time those words were spoken, they were spoken by the Lord himself as he was banishing Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden. And when we hear those words, remember, you are dust, and to dust you will return, it reminds us where we actually live. We don't live in the Garden of Eden. We live outside of the Garden of Eden. And then when we hear those words, you are dust, and to dust you will return, and we feel the ashes on our forehead, it reminds us who we really are. We're dust. And no one else is saying in the world, we're doing everything we can to avoid that reality, but we are dust. Someday, someone will attend your funeral. And Lent allows us to strip away any false narrative when we can look that reality straight in the face because we know what we actually need. And we get it through Lent as we look forward to Holy Week. Lent ends with Holy Week as we see not just Jesus on a cross, but him coming out of an empty tomb, which reminds us that we need not just the forgiveness of sins, we need a resurrected Savior. We are dust, and so what we really need is to be resurrected, and that's what Jesus promises. He promises to resurrect us from the dust. It strips away any false narrative and allows us to see reality, and we don't need to be scared of it. And that's what this text does also. As we go to the Garden of Gethsemane, it does the same thing for us. It strips away any false narratives that we're trying to live under. It tells us where we really live, who we really are, and what we really need. So I want to go back and read to you verses 32 through 34. It says this. They went to the place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Now, this literally happened. We know there is a place called the Garden of Gethsemane. It's in the Mount of Olives. In fact, you could take a plane ride today and go see this literal place. They really went there, and Jesus really was overwhelmed with sorrow. This event happened, But this event also reminds us where we live. This is where we live. We don't live in the Garden of Eden. We live in a place a lot more like the Garden of Gethsemane. A place where there is real sorrow, a sorrow that Jesus said was killing him. A place where Jesus said, keep watch. And the reason he said keep watch is because at that exact same time, Judas was gathering a group of people to come and attack Jesus. And so Jesus was saying in a world, keep watch, because in this garden, snakes like to come in. It reminds us where we really live, and we need to hear that, because on a nice, bright, sunny day like today, we can look out into the world, and we have this idea, and it is a good world. God created a good world, but sometimes we forget that this world has been corrupted by sin. And we might believe this false narrative that if we just had the right government or the right plans or we tried hard enough, somehow we could restore this world back to Eden on our own strength. But Jesus strips us of that false narrative and says, you don't live in the Garden of Eden right now. For right now, until I return, you live in a garden that's a lot more like the Garden of Gethsemane. And as we go on, it shows us who we really are. He goes on, he says, going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he doesn't call him the rock, he calls him Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. So Jesus goes away to pray to his Father. He knows the agony that he's about to suffer. He's going to take on the weight of the sins of the world. And so he tells his disciples to be there with him, to comfort him, to encourage him, to keep watch. But he goes back and he finds them sleeping. And this episode not only tells us something about the disciples, but tells us something about who we are. So it was just a few moments earlier where Peter was the one who was saying, you know what, even if everybody falls away, Jesus, I never will. And we might think that too. We might think, you know what, I'm never going to fall away. I'm never going to walk away from Jesus. I'm never going to screw this up. I can do this on my own. And Jesus teaches us who we really are. He says, yeah, your spirit might be willing, but your flesh is weak. Lent is this time where we come to the grips of who we really are. We're weak. And that's why Jesus tells them, he says, so watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. And that's what the whole Lenten journey is. It's an opportunity to try to follow Jesus in this wilderness journey. And so people do different things to watch and pray. They try to follow what Jesus did. When he was in the wilderness, he was tested and tempted as he fasted and prayed. And so people throughout the centuries have tried to enter into Lent to be tested as they fast and prayed. And so this year I tried something different. I tried fasting. Not from food, I don't think I could pull that off, but tried fasting from social media, Facebook and Twitter. You know, I told myself that I needed these things to stay connected with people and do ministry, but I was seeing that they were just taking this unhealthy hold in my life, distracting me from really serving people, and so I said, you know what, I'm going to fast from these things. And it lasted for a while, and then a few days ago, somebody said to me, you know, there's this thing on Facebook, you need to connect with this person, you got to do this thing, and so I opened it all back up, let it all back in my life, and I didn't need to go back there, and it reminded me exactly what Jesus is saying here. Your spirit might be willing, but man, you're weak. And that's who we really are, and that's why Jesus goes on to tell us what we actually need. Because he says, once more they went away and he prayed the same thing. And when he came back again, he found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. They didn't know what to say anymore. You see, Jesus, he gave them good teaching, watch and pray. He gave them good advice. He gave them a step-by-step process as to what they were to do. And even with the best teaching and advice, they still fell. They still couldn't keep watch. They still couldn't be there to encourage him. They still couldn't stay awake. And so what they needed is more than just good advice. What do we really need? We need what Jesus offers here. He says, returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Arise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. We need a Savior who says, enough, I'm going to do it. I'm going to go face my betrayer. I'm going to go walk up to Golgotha. I'm going to put myself on that cross, and I'm going to walk through that grave. I'm going to pay for the sins of the world, and I'm going to give them the gift of eternal life, of the resurrection. We are weak. That's who we are. And so what we really need is a resurrected body. And as Paul says it, he says, when Jesus returns, he's going to transform our lowly bodies to be like his glorious body. That's what we really need. And so it is such a blessing to participate in Lent with you, because we need to experience this 40-day journey of having all of our false narratives stripped away. We need to remember where we really live. We don't live in the Garden of Eden. We live in the Garden of Gethsemane, where there is sorrow and snakes. We need to remember who we really are. As strong as we want to be, as much as we try, we still are weak. And so there is never going to be a day when we don't need to watch and pray, when we don't need to desperately hold on to Jesus with everything we got. And that shows us what we really need. We need Holy Week. And as we participate in Lent, we will long for the thing that only Jesus can give, and he gives it on Easter. And so watch. Watch the world you live in, because in this world there is sorrow and snakes. Watch your own heart, because it is weak and it can easily be led astray. Watch Jesus, who walks all the way to the cross and through the empty tomb. But more than anything, watch. Keep your eyes watching as you look forward to Jesus' return. And when he does, he will turn our weak bodies to be like his glorious body. Amen. And I will continue with a responsive prayer. Please stand. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Keep me as the apple of your eye. In righteousness I shall see you. Be present, O merciful God, and protect us through the silent hours of this night, so that we who are wearied by the changes and chances of this fleeting world may rest in your eternal changelessness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and keep us. Amen. You may be seated for our final hymn. Well, thank you again for worshiping with us this evening. Just a couple quick announcements. First of all, Paul Kazenbach received a call to Bethany in Manitowoc, so keep him and his family in your prayers, please. And then this time we'll welcome the ushers to usher you out from the back to the front. May the Lord bless your evening.